Thank you. Well, that piece was actually written by Turlo O'Carolan, and that was Variations on a Scottish Air. And that was in honor of Benjamin Franklin, who invented the glass harmonica. He saw someone playing the upright wine glasses in England in 1761, and so he came up with the glass, modern glass harmonica. Here is the glasses are blown by a master glass blower, and these don't require any water for tuning, so you can see it's quite a sophisticated version of the upright wine glasses. Benjamin Franklin loved this instrument, and no matter where he went, he always would take his glass harmonica with him and play it for wherever he was staying, at a boarding house or going to someone's home, have dinner at someone's home for a party or whatever. He always took his glass harmonica with him. And so this is Ben Franklin's invention, first American instrument.
Thank you.
you. Benjamin Franklin was actually in England when he invented this instrument, and it took him quite a while to get the first one made. And we know it was made in 1761 because the first virtuoso premiered this instrument, I think, in January of 1762, and that was Marianne Davies. And she was the first virtuoso to travel all over Europe, introducing this instrument to the upper class of society. She taught Marie Antoinette and all of her sisters how to play glass harmonica. Franz Anton Mesmer also learned how to play from Marianne Davies, and in fact, he had an even better instrument than she did. But it was definitely part of the upper class of society back in the late 1700s. That last piece was Bring Him Home. I'm going to go ahead and play the Mozart. Mozart wrote two pieces for this instrument. He had started writing a third, but never finished it. So this is the solo adagio for glass harmonica. The other piece that he did complete was a quintet for glass harmonica. And these are two of the only works that you can get from a regular publisher today. All of the other literature for this instrument has to be hand copied out of the archives of different museums or libraries. None of them are available publicly today. So this is the Mozart solo adagio for glass harmonica. That piece is probably typical of what the virtuosos played at the end of the 18th century. It's three or four voices, fairly slow, and of course pretty short, because when your hands dry out, you're pretty much done playing. The glasses have to stay a little bit wet so you can slide as the glass is spinning around. Now, as I said, Mesmer had a finer instrument than Marianne Davies, and Mesmer, his wife was extremely rich, and they would give lavish parties. All of the upper class of society was in attendance at his parties. And at these parties, he would perform on the glass harmonica, so he's probably one of the other people that's most responsible for popularizing this instrument. Germany was where most of these instruments were made, and Mozart, he just loved it. Wolfgang Mozart actually did learn how to play glass harmonica. He learned on Franz Anton Mesmer's instrument when he was 17 years old. And he didn't actually write any music for it, though, until 1791, when he heard Marianne Kirschgesner, who was the most famous of all the virtuosos. But fortunately, everybody loved this instrument. It was right up there with the piano and the violin. This is probably one of the top three most popular instruments. You could walk into a pharmacy and buy bottled water just for the glass harmonica. They were printing music for this in the newspapers of the day. People were so anxious to get their hands on music for this instrument. Like I said, though, unfortunately, the only two that you can run out to the store today and buy are the two Mozart pieces. The rest of them, you better get out your trusty manuscript paper and start hand copying. Mesmer, that's kind of one of the scandals associated with this instrument. We'll tell you about that later. But he was a psychologist, and so he would use this instrument to help relax his patients. He would perform on the glass harmonica for them. And so if you're wondering about hypnotism, that's from this instrument with Mesmer. Mesmer would hypnotize people to work his therapy and make them more receptive state of mind, and so he used this instrument to do that. This piece is a little bit longer. It's still slow, so it might, if you nod off, that's understandable. Thank you. I see you're still awake. Isn't that about one of the most relaxing sounds you've ever heard? I think so, that as the glasses are going around, they're all handmade, and they have a little bit of wobble to them, I think, and you just can't predict the sound. I don't think it's possible to synthesize this instrument. It's just the fingers touching the glasses, it cannot be duplicated. It just doesn't work. I'm going to go ahead and switch instruments here. As I said, this is the Cadillac of glass instruments, or Lexus, or BMW, whatever. This is 1761, but there were a lot of other glass instruments. I'm going to go ahead and go to the glass xylophone. Okay, over here, this instrument is a cheaper version of the glass harmonica. That was quite expensive in the 18th century, still pretty expensive today. This is called a grand harmonicon back in the early 1800s. I think that was just, they were stealing the name from this instrument, harmonica, grand harmonicon, so they could sell these a little bit cheaper. And this instrument had a couple method books written for it in 1825 and 1840. So again, this is not a brand new instrument for the 20th or 21st century. This has been around for quite a while, too. I'm going to go ahead and play, of course, our own arrangements of some pieces for this instrument. I do have both copies of the method book from the 1800s. I don't know that there are any other pieces available for this instrument. They were probably lost over the years. But this one is Try to Remember. This was probably played with cork or with mallets covered with felt back in the early 1800s. I've got rubber mallets here. In case I didn't mention it before, my degree is actually in percussion performance. So anything you can hit, shake, or rub. This is a keyboard instrument, percussive attack. Obviously, this is a friction idiophone, in case any of you wanted to wonder technically what the method of playing that was. So, percussion, anything you can hit, shake, or rub. This is the rubbing, this is the hitting portion of the program. This is also known as a crystal marimba. So this next piece, you're probably going to know why it's called crystal marimba on this next one. Thank you. I started with two octaves and expanded this to 2.5 octaves. This was built for me by a gentleman in Maine, but if you want, you could build your own. You just need to get quarter-inch plate glass, just a regular window, cut it into the right length bars and mount it on the frame. My husband and I didn't have time to do that. We're too busy writing and arranging all of my music to perform. So there you have the crystal marimba or the glass xylophone or the grand harmonicon. Now this is there's also a crystal bachet, there's crystal handbells. Dean Shostak and Williams had a crystal violin made. There's a whole lot of glass instruments out there, but the very first glass instrument consists of musical bowls, and these are tuned with different amounts of water. I have lined these up, a row of white keys and a row of black keys, because I'm a keyboard-oriented person. In India, the person would be sitting on the ground. They'd have 22 bowls arranged in a circle around them, and they'd be playing the bowls that way. China, Japan, everybody had these instruments back at least as far as the year 700. So this has been around for quite a while, but I'm not going to play that old of a piece. Again, this is another arrangement that my husband and I have done. I have a lot of nice bowl pieces. They're a lot of fun. These do not have any amplification. And if you're interested in getting started in glass music, this is probably the cheapest, least expensive way to get started in glass music. I think I've probably got $1 per bowl invested there. But you do have to, I recommend you take a tuner with you when you go to the thrift store or to the store. They may look at you a little funny and leave you alone in the back corner back there when you're testing all the glasses. But you'll save a lot of money if you take a tuner with you when you go to the store, unless you have perfect pitch. Otherwise, you're going to be like me and you have a couple hundred extra bowls because you came home, you swore it was the note you needed, and it was the wrong one. These are a lot of fun. You just need to get a couple little dowel rods or bamboo rattan sticks and get your bowls all tuned and have at it. The glass harmonica is a little bit harder because I had to learn to actually make the sound, and I'm a percussionist, so I'm used to plunking out the key on the piano or hitting it with the stick and out would come the sound. The problem was hitting the right note or getting at the right volume, being with the rest of the group, but I never had to worry about making the sound. 1740 was when they first started rubbing glass, and ever since then, this has always been the favorite method of tone production for glass music, is performing on glass with the fingers, rubbing with the fingers. I think there were some keyboards they tried to add to the glass harmonica. Somebody even tried to add violin bows to it, but of course that didn't work. None of those instruments survived. I think they were just theoretical papers that never came to anything. Mary Ann Davies, her sister was a very famous soprano, and when she was singing, they said that they couldn't separate her voice from the glass harmonica, that this is most like the human voice compared to all the other instruments. So I'm going to go ahead and play All I Ask of You by Andrew Lloyd Webber. This instrument, next time you hear the word harmonica, I want you to make sure you're thinking about this instrument, because this was invented in 1761. Benjamin Franklin thought that the Italians had such a musical, lyrical language, and so in Italian, harmonica would mean harmonious and resonant, so that's where the name of this instrument came from. Now, this was so popular at the end of the 18th century that when they invented the mouth organ, I think around 1821, they stole the name from this instrument. So the next time you hear harmonica, make sure you're thinking about this instrument and not the mouth organ. I won't even call the the harmonica. Harmonica. I always call it a mouth organ now because they stole the name from this one. This is the harmonica. Probably already figured it out by now, but the only way I can get louder on this instrument is to add more voices. Benjamin Franklin liked playing single voices, Scottish and Irish tunes. He said that when the glasses were ringing and you played the notes, they kept ringing, and when you went to the next note, it formed its own harmony and its own chords. So he liked playing single voice melodies, but the virtuosos would do three and four voices. But that's about the only way I can get any louder is to add more voices. And in case you're wondering how I know where the notes are, the clear ones are the white keys on the piano, and the ones that have the gold bands are the black keys on the piano. And I have about 42 bowls here, which would be the top half of a piano. Now, this instrument, they were fairly expensive in the 18th century. They're fairly expensive today. So most of us that started, that play glass music today, started on other instruments and then kind of switched over to glass music. We kind of got hooked with the feel of rubbing the glass and the sound. And so most of us were already trained musicians, because it's not like you go out and spend that kind of money on an instrument and then decide that you don't like it. So, but if you really fall in love with how the feel of the instrument is and the sound, you know, then it's probably not any more expensive than another instrument, you know, a nice piano, a harp, flute. It's fairly expensive today because they are all custom made to order. Mine was made by Gerhard Finkenbeiner in Waltham, Massachusetts. I started off with just 2 1/3 octaves, which was enough to play the Mozart solo adagio. And of course, being a percussionist, you can ask my husband down here, more is always better. I have a lot of toys at home, lots of, you know, so then I had to go get a xylophone. Then I had to put some bowls together, and I have the wine glasses. But then I had to have more notes, too. So we just kept adding on, adding on. In the 18th century, somebody expanded this to 4 octaves. I've got 3 1/2. Thomas Jefferson wanted to order a 6-octave instrument. He never did get one. He stuck with the violin when he found out how much they cost, and they didn't come 6 octaves. But that's one of the reasons they died out in the 18th century, is because they were so expensive. And if you can imagine going from town to town and taking your glass harmonica with you, and you've got it on the back of the carriage, and they're going down the cobblestone streets with those wooden wheels, and by the time you got to the next stop, chances are you had a lot of glasses that were broken, and they were pretty hard to acquire even in those days. I mean, you had to go to a little bit of trouble to get a glass harmonica. So, and then, of course, they're difficult to play well. But we're making a comeback because Gerhard Finck and Miner started making glass harmonicas again. And so I don't get a commission, but if anybody's interested, I will put you in touch with my glassware. I will even give free lessons, but you have to get your own instrument because nobody touches this one except me. Even my husband doesn't get to touch this one, just I do. So this is one of our newer arrangements. This is Scarborough Fair. My husband's sitting down here in the front, helps me write and arrange, and he's done some original compositions for my instrument. He's responsible for all of the background music that you're hearing, the orchestrations, recording all the parts, burning the CD and mixing everything, because I'm an orchestral player and he's a retired band director, so you know, one instrument gets kind of boring, so we like to have a lot of accompaniment and things. And so here's our arrangement of Scarborough Fair.
Thank you.
this next piece it's in a minor key, and this part of the reason that the glass harmonica died out at the end of the 18th century is they thought that it caused nervous disorders. So if you are a person who is prone to depression, you should avoid listening to glass harmonica music. Definitely you should avoid playing it, because the vibrations transfer themselves through your nervous system and could directly affect you. Listening to it can affect you. Supposedly at some concerts, children cry, dogs bark, women faint, a lot of scandals associated with. And of course, Mesmer, using it for his hypnotism and being quite an accomplished player, didn't help matters. He was run out of town for quackery, so that didn't help, because they associated him with the glass harmonica too. So I'm going to go ahead and play this one in a minor key, but hopefully it's a short piece, so you won't feel inclined that you're getting too depressed or anything like that. This is one of those pieces that was published in a newspaper in 1800, one of those that everybody was anxious to get their hands on, and it was actually published in a newspaper. But again, you have to get the 1800 copy of the paper to get this. It's not published today. So this is Largo for harmonica, and it's written by Johann Schultz. Everyone still feeling okay? No, I think the ones that they analyzed, in case you're wondering if these were made out of lead crystal, no, they weren't made out of lead crystal. The ones that have been analyzed were not made out of lead crystal. I can't say that they didn't use lead paint on some of them, but no, these are not made out of lead crystal. I'm going to go ahead and leave things on a lighter note. I don't know if any of you are Star Wars fans, but my husband and I had to do an arrangement of Cantina Band for the Bowl. So this is a little bit upbeat, more cheerful after that last piece, just in case you're getting depressed. So here is Cantina Band. Thank you. you. Thank you. Got one more? One more? This'll put you back to sleep again, but that's okay. It's almost time to turn in for the evening. Nice way to unwind.
This is somewhere in time.